So now let's talk about the idea of a probability distribution of a discrete random variable. We know what a discrete random variable is now, so let's talk about what the idea of the distribution. Now, by definition, the probability distribution for a discrete random variable is really nothing more than a table or a function that lists all the possible outcomes and associated probabilities of a discrete random variable. Okay, so what does that really mean? Well, the idea of a table, some type of listing. Well, we looked at craps some time ago and listed the probabilities for craps. Well, once I listed every possible outcome and the probability for the outcome, I have now established the discrete probability distribution for the game of craps. If I could represent that as some kind of a function, remember functions like an algebra, f of x equals mx plus b, the equation of a line. If there's some type of function, not the equation of a line, but some type of function that given x being the, say, number of successes in a binomial or whatever it is that we're looking for, if there's some type of function that will produce all those probabilities, then we have the probability distribution function for that particular process. Now, I just mentioned the idea of a binomial. Don't trip on that yet. That's actually coming up, and we actually look at the binomial distribution. That term just kind of slipped, and I didn't want you to go, "Oh God, oh my gosh, what is that?" and suddenly realize you don't know. It's not that big of a deal. It's coming up. So, a probability distribution is actually a theoretical distribution. And by theoretical distribution, what we really mean is that it's associated with the population probabilities, the true probabilities of an event. Now, we can't have empirical distributions. We can create an empirical probability distribution, but if we do, we actually specify that it is an empirical probability distribution. And whatever you see the term probability distribution, right away you know you're talking about the true theoretical values. If it was specifically an empirical probability distribution, the word empirical would be there. Okay, some quick properties of a proper probability distribution. Number one, all probabilities are on 0, 1. So every event will have a probability that has a minimum of 0 and maximum of 1 and the infinite number of possibilities in between. The sum of all probabilities of the entire sample space is 1. That should intuitively feel right. If I add up the probability of everything inside my sample space, I've then considered everything, which is my entire universe, which is one, it's the whole thing. So a quick check, whenever you list a discrete probability distribution, is to just quickly look at every single probability and make sure you don't have any negative probabilities. You don't have any probabilities bigger than one. That's like step number one. Step number two is add up all those probabilities. If the sum, that's what the sum means, to add up. If you add up all the probabilities and it's not equal to one, you need to ask yourself why, because there's a problem. Now, it could be a simple rounding issue. If you came up with 1.0001, okay, I'm thinking that's simply rounding and you're fine. Don't worry about it. Likewise, if you came up with 0.9998 or something like that, that's just rounding. It's not a big deal. If you came up with 1.13, I would get seriously concerned very, very, very quickly. All right, so let's take a quick look at an example here. So let's consider tossing four coins and recording the number of heads. We did this earlier with three. So four is going to be the exact same thing, just has one more step. So it's going to be a little bit more involved. So I'm going to start here, and this would be like the first coin, a head or a tail. Then this would be like the second coin, again a head or a tail with possibilities. Then my third coin, a head or a tail. And now I'm out here at my fourth coin. And I'm just going to keep doing this table just like we did before. It's going to get a little bit crunched. So if you're doing this on your paper, you may want to try to spread it out a bit. So here I just completed this table. Like I said, it got a little bit crunched in there trying to fit it all in. Should probably have made these a little bit bigger, but the point is they're all here. So let's start working on this probability distribution. Now I'm going to say, let's use H. So little h is going to represent the number of observed heads. And then I'm going to use a probability statement. This is the probability that capital H equals little h. Now that may seem a little bit confusing, but these capital letters are used to represent the random variable. In this case, it's heads. That's what capital letters are used for. The lowercase letters are used to represent an actual observed number. That's why, if you haven't noticed, when I write x's, my x's are different. If I just write an x, is that a capital X or a little x? Well, if you say it's a little x, I make one bigger. Now this is capital, so you know, it gets a bit confusing. So to me, that's a capital X. I don't care how physically big it is, that's a capital X. And then I make my lowercase x's like this, because it's very important to distinguish between a capital and lower. Likewise, a p, is that a capital P or lowercase p? Well, if it's written like this, then you know it is a capital. But if it's not, if it's just by itself, you don't know. So you may want to put something on there that you know it, that's a capital letter. Random variables like O's are probably not a good idea. It's kind of hard to distinguish capital O's from lowercase O's. So the point here is that you need to be able to distinguish between upper and lowercase. Okay, so what could happen? We have four coins. We could get absolutely zero heads. We could get one head, we could get two heads, we could get three heads, or we could get four heads. So I'm gonna go through here. Let's see, here's one, two, three, four. There's four heads, there's one of those. And then there's three heads and a tail, so that'd be three heads. I just took that path. Then I have two heads, a tail, and another head, so that's another three heads on that path, so there's another one. And then here there's two heads and two tails, so that'd be two heads. That takes care of that path. Then following along this path, it looks like there's three heads and one tail. So there'd be another one here. And then following along this path, that would be head, tail, that's two of each. And then following along this path, there's head, tail, head. Again, that is two of each. And then following along this path, there's head, tail. That'd be one head. Now coming down on this path, I see there's tail, head. That's three heads. And then on this path, I see tail, head. That means there's two of them. And this path, again, there's two of each. And then on this path, there's one head and three tails. So I'm here. Then following this path, again, there's two of each. And then this path, there's three tails and one head. So that'd be one of those guys. And this path, again, there's three tails and one head. And then there's all tails. Okay, each of these outcomes, every time I flip a coin, there's two things that could happen, and there's four coins, so I should have two of the fourth options here, which is 16, and that's what I have. I have a total of 16. So the probability of getting no heads is 1 out of 16. This is 4 out of 16. That's the probability of getting one head. And then this is 6 out of 16. That's the probability of getting two heads. And the probability of getting three heads is 4 out of 16. And the probability of getting all heads was 1 out of 16. Now, I'm not going to reduce these. And the reason I'm not going to reduce these is I need to add these up. And what I do, what do I get? I get 16 out of 16. See, if I were to reduce these, it would have been kind of a mess to add them because I had to find the lowest common denominator again and so forth and etc. So, first of all, each of these probabilities is on 0, 1. None of these are negative, none of them bigger than 1. So, the first part is a check. Got it. I added them all up, and it ended up to 16 over 16, which obviously equals 1. So this is a proper probability distribution for flipping 4 coins. Now there is an assumption here, and the assumption is that each of these coins is fair. Okay, I'll say that again. The assumption is that each of these coins is a fair coin. A fair coin simply means the probability of getting a head is the same as getting a tail. Now, if I had some type of a function, and I actually, looking at this, I might be able to come up with some kind of a function, I'm not sure. But if I had some type of function that would represent this, then I could represent this entire table as a function. The first one you will see is actually in the next chapter when we talk about the binomial. That's the first time we're going to actually have a probability distribution function that is real. There may be some exercises in the back of your book that has some type of function. So if you have some practice, you'll see it, but it probably really doesn't represent anything real as of yet.